Hello, I am Grandmaster Mikhail Marin from Bucharest, Romania, and I invite you to discuss a few typical aspects of Fischer's strategic approach to chess. I believe that there is no such a thing as a one-sided description of Fischer's playing style. First of all, his style changed quite a lot, starting with the moment when he entered the high scene of world chess at the age of 15. And also, in the later years, his style was quite rounded up, complete, multifaceted. So it is not easy to describe him by one stroke. Earlier, some of his opponents, the Soviets, would focus on his excellent opening preparation and some tactical attacks. He had some famous attacking games, nice combinations, but I don't remember that there was any big talk about his strategic vision. And I believe that this was actually the main background of Fischer's success, is not only his passion for chess, but also his understanding of the game as a whole. Sometimes he made some gave some evaluations to certain positions, which looked a little bit too categoric. It made some grandmasters smile. But later it was proof that he was right. He had been right just because he understood those positions. So he had some special power of getting the strategic nuances of the positions, which were not noticed by many. In any case, by the moment he started his final campaign for his final attack of the world title in 1970, when he won the Palma de Mallorca Interzonal by a large margin, it was obvious that his style had become more rounded up than earlier. His opening repertoire became wider, and he was not always relying on opening preparation, not always aiming for sharp attacks. At times, as in the game we are going to see now, he just wanted to play chess, some slow chess, strategic chess, where the best strategist would eventually win. So this was played in the first part of the interzonal. It is one of the three games that Fischer started with the move b3, which was quite a surprise. He always played e4 before. Obviously, there is nothing forced here. You cannot not even guess how the opponent would develop. And then, actually, we see that Fischer deviates from what would be the Larsen-Inzovic attack, where the bishop usually goes to e2 or eventually to b5, if allowed. Now he opts for a double fianchetto, and now, by transposition, we have a modern tabia, modern and classic, and it has always been topical, tabia of the Reti opening. The main move here is e3, the most flexible move, but at the same time, it does not really suit Fischer's strategic approach. Fischer was very, very clear in his intentions. He didn't like letting any doubt about his intentions, because a move like e3 leaves the structure uncertain, and white somehow keeps the option to take on d5 or maintain the tension, or play d3, followed by e4, several plans. But no, Fischer openly aimed for a position against the black Isolani by taking on d5. E takes d5 would have transposed it to a Tarash, but Philip preferred to keep to delay the moment when the Isolani would rise. Bishop f6, queen c1. Queen c1, for the time being, it may only seem as an attempt to avoid losing a tempo after knight b4, after queen c2. But actually, we'll see that there is more about this. The queen placement here is useful also for some other purposes, which will become clear later, which means that actually Fischer already had some strategic vision about what would happen in the game. B6, d4, bishop a6, rook e1. Well, looking at this piece placement with the queen c1 and rook e1, apparently modest development on the background, back row rank, I can't help thinking of some of Karpov's games in the Queen's Indian. He had such positions against Andrei Sokolov twice in the Candidate Superfinal in 87. He had it against some other players in the same opening. So I believe that we can notice certain pre-Karpovian elements in Fischer's play. Knight takes d4. And now quite an interesting move. Bishop takes d4. Bishop takes d4, which gives a lot of meaning to White's play from the previous phase, because now the queen emerges on an active square. It forces, more or less forces, the bishop to retreat, and it it clears the path for the a1 rook, restoring what might have seemed as slightly artificial coordination forces. Bishop b7. Of course, queen c8 has been recommended, but I don't see... the idea was that black can avoid the Isolani, but I don't see why this is so good for black. White's pieces are more active, the d5 pawn is vulnerable, there are this pressure along the long diagonal, the queen and the bishop are badly placed, it's not really equality for black. Bishop b7, rook d1. With the next series of moves, black will be trying to get some initiative for to compensate for his isolated pawn. Actually, he plays a good game so far. Knight d4, bishop e3, bishop e5, queen e3. We see that Fischer's queen Fischer does not place the queen at once on d2, which is the safer square. He keeps it active. Well, for instance, on f4, it was quite useful, because here black cannot play yet the useful move g6. And after bishop e5, queen e3, the bishop is hanging in some positions, because it is clear that actually white does not have an advantage yet. White's position is stable. He has a relatively good blockade of the Isolani. He keeps it under observation. He cannot lose. If he just starts moving rook d2, rook e d1, he can never lose his position. It's only white who can play for a win. But at the same time, the black dark squared bishop is very strong, and it prevents an absolutely safe blockade of the d pawn, and it means that black should be able to survive this this position. And this is why, by keeping his queen active, Fischer tries to give some small dynamic nuances to the position, so that he forces, by dynamic means, a favorable strategic evolution of the position. And Fischer now, according to his own confession, he had two main candidates here. The first one was bishop h3, which was not played in the game. Bishop h3, the purpose is quite simple. If rook c5, then knight e6, and a very favorable exchange of pieces has been carried out. White is clearly better. The b7 bishop is bad. That's an ugly position for black. There is f5, but f5, okay. Not everybody would take into account such a further weakening of the king side. This can be dangerous. The seventh rank is weak. It can become very dangerous. And the Fischer mainly rejected bishop h3 because of bishop takes d4. And I didn't find any further explanation about this, but probably because bishop takes d4 is a concession, actually. It's what he wants to get. But the problem is that here black gets in time to get some counterplay. White has to exchange rooks. And after the exchange of one pair of rooks, black's position is not not so bad anymore. The weakness of the d5 pawn is almost bearable. It's a better position than in the game. I'm not sure if the move played by Fischer was stronger objectively, but it led to more favorable conclusions. Knight b5. Knight b5 attacks two pawns, the a6 pawn and the d5 pawn, and the e5 bishop is hanging. The exchange now is possible only with queen takes b5, which was played in the game, and is actually it's a big strategy concession. The problem is that if a6, then bishop takes d5. There is some simple tactics. Black can play this, but okay, in this position, he's a pawn down, and the draw is not really obvious. I mean, white has good winning chances here. Probably the best would have been rook c5. Rook c5, because now knight takes a8 looks dangerous. There is d4 coming, for instance, and the knight would be badly placed on a7. And if a4, for instance, then some commentators recommended bishop b8. I'm not sure if this is so good, because the bishop on b8 does not have good moves. At some point, white could even break the center with e4, and then the bishop would stand badly on b8. So probably the best would be to play a6, knight d4, and it's not very clear if white has made such a big progress. There is some mutual weakening of the on the queen side, so this is probably still an equal position. After queen takes b5, now Fischer practically obtained what he really wanted, meaning a one-sided, very one-sided game with big pressure against the Isolani. Queen b2. Finally, the queen arrives. Now that everything was done from the initial phase of construction, the queen arrives on a typical square, the b2 square, which had been slightly weak with b3, but now is useful for the queen. So now we simply see a Karpovian, almost Karpovian style of attacking the d5 pawn. There is this famous Karpov game against Korchnoi, against the Isolani, with three major pieces. Here there are the bishops, which make things a little bit worse for black. And it must be said that from this moment Fischer plays easily. He actually, h4 makes part of his plan, but is probably not the best. He should probably have doubled the rooks first, because h4 loses sometimes, and it would have allowed some black activity at a later stage. But okay, h4 is not really a bad move. This rook, rook d2, and now probably queen c6 would have been a good move, intending to play rook c2 and to somehow simplify and get the same kind of positions with one rook exchanged. But Philip missed this chance, and now everything was going back to normal. Queen c5. It is interesting that here Fischer could have played a forced variation, just won the pawn like this. He probably thought that this is not so clear, and actually it's not really obvious why this is bad for black. Here there is queen c3. Apparently everything is defended now, but queen a3 threatens rook d8 mate with a mating attack, and then queen f6 needs to be played in order to defend the d8 and defend the rook indirectly, and then rook d6. And now black cannot defend both threats, meaning f takes g3 and rook d8, and he has to sacrifice the rook. And well, even this is somehow optically not very clear, but actually the king escapes. The king can escape the perpetual check. It's true that there is some some uncertainty left after queen g5. Okay, the g3 pawn will be lost. But okay, objectively it should be won for white. But Fischer did not want to change the course of the game. He simply felt that I suppose that his game is strategically won, and he just the first thing he did was placing all his pawns on light squares. I mean, this is what one should do when there are light squared bishops on the board. h5 in order to prevent h4, but now we see that there is another black pawn on a light square, so black is forced to do the opposite. A3, king h7, black cannot do very much. And eventually now, after consolidating, Fischer takes the pawn. He takes this pawn. Now there is nothing to be attacked along the second rank. So that was the point behind his previous moves. Queen e4, black tries to get some counterplay. Rook d8. Queen f3, king h2. We see that both players have some plans on the long diagonals, but here it becomes clear that somehow white's strategic planning had been more effective, because the c3 rook is pinned, and black cannot really continue his attack in any way. Whereas the threat rook f8 and rook takes f7 is killing. Black cannot go here, because then his rook would get under a pin. So the threat rook f8 is just killing. Okay, Philip tried some desperate move g5. Of course, if he takes g5, then h4 would be good, but rook f8, king g6, well, king g7, that doesn't change too much, because here white has a big material advantage, and rook c2, it may seem that the f2 pawn is falling, but actually now this is only an optical illusion, because now, after the latest changes, the queen gets this fantastic square, and white is just winning. Defense f2 with tempo, and so king g6 he played, but okay, then he got under a different kind of attack. Now there is no tension on the king side. White has two pawns up, and also the black king is very weak. Rook d5, and okay. Black decided to resign. He cannot defend his f7 and h5 pawns at the same time. So I think this game, although, let's say, it didn't prove anything concrete for right after the opening, it's just impressive, because Fischer relied on the fact that in the long run he'll play better than his opponent. He'll understand what to do with the pieces, how to regroup, how to place his pawns. I mean, he relied on the fact that he would be the better strategist. And actually, the final result proved it.